Amen. As you're seated, I want to welcome you here to Kings Grant Presbyterian Church as we come and proclaim God's grace is enough for us. And so we come to praise and worship and give thanks to Almighty God. And then we are sent out to go and grow, shine, and love this week. So welcome to each and every one of you. I'd like to invite you to sign the friendship pad, which is on your pew, somewhere toward the center aisle. If you would fill that out for us, we would appreciate it. We also want to welcome anyone who might be a first or second time visitor. We have some hospitality bags that we hand out. Is anyone here for the first or second time today? Welcome, welcome. Do we have little bags somewhere? All right, there they are. All right, perfect. Right behind Betsy. Welcome, welcome to every one of you. Today's a big day, and it's a very exciting day. There's lots of things happening. So this evening, we continue with our Sunday evening potluck dinners. I have to tell you, there was some good food last week. That's at 5:30. You're welcome to come out, bring a potluck dish to share. And then at 6:30, we have classes. We have two classes for adults, one for our children, and hopefully come out and share some time with your church family this evening. We are going to start a First Friday small groups. And so the first Friday of every month, you will be invited to come and share and gather together, sometimes over food, sometimes at a restaurant, sometimes at people's houses or here at the church. We're going to do that for the rest of this year, and then in January kind of start a larger program. So this first Friday of October, you're welcome to come to Why Not Pizza. I believe you have to RSVP, so read your announcements, and I think right outside there's a sign-up sheet for those who would like to come. We need some people to make soup for JCOC as we live out our discipleship and love our neighbor. Today we are also collecting a special offering for Presbyterian Disaster Assistance to go toward the damage and the destruction that was done by Hurricane Florence. And so instead of our 5 cents a meal, you will be invited forward during our last song to place an offering for hurricane relief, and all those funds will go toward Presbyterian Disaster Assistance to help. And a note of celebration, between services, our session will meet to receive 40 new members that are coming from Thalia Trinity Presbyterian Church. So they will be kind of up front here at the 11 o'clock service, but it's an exciting day, and I hope that, you know, eventually we'll get all the pictures up and you'll be able to put faces to names if you haven't already, and it's just a great way to celebrate joining together, and so we look forward to that today. And now, as we continue worship, I want to invite you to pass the peace of Christ with one another. authentically share the good news of Jesus Christ with others by what we say, by what we do. Holy God, we ask that you hear us now as we offer to you our silent prayers of personal confessions. Amen. It's here at the baptismal font that we remember that we're a forgiven people. We're forgiven through Jesus Christ, who lived and died and rose again, that we might have eternal life. So in joy, we proclaim this day and every day, really, truly, we are forgiven. May we go out and live as a forgiven people. Alleluia. Amen.
You.
As you are seated, I want to invite up our young disciples along with Bruce McCall for a message for you guys. Come on up.
I have goosebumps. I'm not gonna lie. I have goosebumps. So can you see them? You can probably see them. It is for me individually, for everybody coming from Thalia, and even for those of us here at King's Grant. It's a new life. So I challenged myself. In a way, I wish I never had done this, but I challenged myself to do a children's message about new life. So I'm gonna put the pressure on you guys first before I show my slides. I had the advantage of time to prepare for this. But I'm curious, do you guys have any examples of new life that you would like to share?
Christmas.
Christmas, okay. That's. What about, I'll give you some hints. School. a school year just started. It's a new school year, a new life. What are you in, like 10th grade now? Sixth and seventh, oh, middle school, wow. See, that's exciting, that's a new life. Not really. Okay, well, you know what then? We're just gonna go straight to my examples because I have some exciting examples of new life. Okay, so you can see on the screen, oh, we got a screen up there. New life, that's the name of my children's message today. That's the sign at the Thalia Trinity Presbyterian Church building. So there's new life at the building where we all used to go to church. They're thriving. We were so excited that another church was able to take over the building and use it to do God's work. But now the fun ones. The second slide. Speaking of new life, this is my daughter and her husband, and that's still hard to say. They got married a year and 2 or 3 months ago. That's a new life, right? Well, guess what? They took it one step further. In the background there, that's the city of Austin, Texas. So now, not only did they get married to start a new life, they went way down to Austin, Texas to start a new life. But good for them. They're really enjoying it. The next example is, I don't know if you can really see that. That's, my wife is probably going to shoot me at the 11 o'clock service. But we've started a new life this summer. My wife retired as a school teacher after 3 years. I can't even get a smile out of you. That's okay. So it's exciting for us. It gets better. I know you're not going to believe that. It gets better. Watch this. The next slide. There, see, I knew I'd get a smile. Ladies and gentlemen, this is my grandson, Robert Bruce McCall III. He was finally born Tuesday of this week. Do you know how hard it was to prepare? I'm preparing for this message, and this was going to be a big part of it, and he was being stubborn. He finally showed up, but I'm a little biased, but he is about as adorable as the day is long. All right, so as much as I love that one, the last picture I'm going to show you is probably my favorite. This is a group from Thalia Trinity, and I believe all of them in that picture will be joining today. We took that picture at the end of our last congregational meeting that we had right here. Now, it's hard to see in the picture, but in the very front, they are holding my flat Jesus. Anybody remember flat Jesus? Yeah, have you sent any pictures in? Okay, we need to work on that, but that's not what this message is about. God works in mysterious ways. I know you've heard that before. To get from where we were to where we are today with 40 people joining King's Grant, it wasn't easy, but God never said it would be easy. And we are so happy, and we are so joyful to be a part of King's Grant and everything that King's Grant has done for us and what we can offer King's Grant moving forward. So to you two, thanks for coming up, and thanks for embracing all of us from Thalia as we do God's work here at King's Grant. So let's say a quick prayer. Dear God, thank you for all that you do and all that you have given us. Help us as we do your will each and every day. Amen. Thank
you. All right. Thank you, Bruce. Today, I want you to remember that when we participate in the offering of this church, we are also participating in our caring ministry. Our care ministry provides an atmosphere for grieving families to gather with loved ones after a funeral. Our care ministry provides food and a place tonight, like on Sunday evenings, to gather for dinner to get to know each other better. They host events that bond our community of faith together, events like men's cake baking and chili cook-off and ladies' tea, among other things. The Garden of Eden is overseen by CARE, along with our visiting deacons who go and visit those who are sick or in the hospital. CARE oversees our prayer chains, our email and phone chains, and our faith nurses who go and visit and care for people who might need some light medical attention or advice. We nurture one another. We strengthen one another in this community as we are a family together through CARE. We give because God has given us everything. We give out of joy and generosity, out of gratitude, as we participate in the ministry of this church and what God is doing in us and through us, as we now share with God our tithes and our offerings. Take what we offer and multiply it for your missionary work in this world. Take our lives, our hearts, our talents, our money, as we freely offer them in your service, that this church and its ministry might thrive under your guidance. We thank you for the privilege of sharing what you have given us as the ministry of this church continues in your name. Bless all that we offer and all that we are. And now, Holy God, as we humbly approach your word this morning, we thank you and trust that you send a message, a word to each of us. May we be receptive to your word, that it may take root and that we might be more faithful followers and dedicated disciples of Jesus Christ. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. Amen. Our scripture this morning is found in the Gospel of Luke, in chapter 10, the first 11 verses. This passage is often titled The Mission of the 70. Hear now God's word to us. After this, the Lord appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs in the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say peace to this house. And if anyone is there who shares in peace, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you. Cure the sick who are there, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not welcome you, go out into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off in protest against you.' Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. As we continue our evangelism sermon series, I have invited Pete Lothrop to come up and to share with us his perspective and his stories about evangelism. Thank you, Pete. There you go.
Good morning. I've heard in previous messages, they talk about the dreaded E word, evangelism. I thought of myself the other day as I'm the dreaded person, the evangelist person. But that's what I like to do. I like to share the message of Jesus Christ. And I like to share with a few nudges which I've received recently. My good friend Roger Kreider were over at Hardee's having our beloved bacon, egg, and cheese biscuit together, getting ready to do some work at the church. And as we were walking out of the Hardee's, Roger said to me, "Did you see that homeless man sitting next to you?" And I said, "No, I didn't really." He said, "Yeah, he was doing a lot of artwork." I said, "Really?" Nudge. So I decided to go on out to my truck and picked up a Bible that I had in my truck. And I have in my pocket, hopefully. I went back to the man and I first decided to start a conversation with him. I said to him, "You're an artist. Those are beautiful drawings. Can you show me some of them? I'm an artist, you're an artist. Show me what you've got." And he showed me these beautiful drawings that he had. Point one, in my mind, build a relationship. That can be a relationship over 5 years or 10 years, or in this particular case at Hardee's, it can be about 20 seconds. I said, "I'd like to give you a Bible. May I give you a Bible?" He said, "Sure." I said, "Here's a Bible that I'd like to give to you, but let me explain a little bit about it. Here in the front, it has helps. If you're worried or desperate or maybe even contemplating suicide, God's Word's got plans and solutions for you and things that will give you comfort. And here's the really good part in the back. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." I explained further to him that for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. and that salvation is a free gift of God, lest any man should boast. There was a story, let me back up just for a second, that I was talking to Julie. And Julie, in the generosity program, said, with any new program, sometimes you have to hear it 8 times before it really sinks in. And I've heard some people explain evangelism in the same way, that it takes 8 times to hear the message before it sinks in. You don't know whether you're the first. You don't know whether you're the 8th person to hear this message or give this message to someone. But anyway, for all of sin come short of the glory of God. So there's a problem here. The wages of sin is death. Death means eternal separation from God, I said to this man. That's not a good thing, eternal separation from God. So up here we have a holy God in heaven, and down here we have sinful man. There's a problem. The guys in the prison know when I say, somebody's going down. Somebody's paying the price. And God worked it out that there is someone who's paying that price. In between heaven, in between man, is the cross, the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And I said to him, do you believe that? And he said, yes, I do. And at that point, I said, well, as far as heaven's concerned, you're in, buddy. What's your name? He said, my name's Vincent. I didn't say buddy. That sounds kind of impersonal. But anyway, I said, could you please sign your name in here, Vincent? And we put a date in there. That's as simple as it is. I couldn't help but walk away going, yes. But that's the way God kind of nudges me. God nudges me in different ways. God nudged me in prison about 2 months ago. I was in a hallway. How am I doing?
So far, so good.
Okay.
You got about 1 more minute, though, so.
There I was outside talking to a prisoner, and I said, how you feeling? He says, I'm scared. I said, why? He said, because I'm getting released in 5 months. I said, why don't you come into Kairos? I can't. I'm getting out in 5 months. I said, I'm kind of sorry for you. So I walked back into the meeting hall and sat down, and God said, go out and talk to that man. And I said to God, no. I'm sitting in the front table here. There's a speaker right there, and I'm not getting up. You're going to have to tell me like twice or something. Get up, Pete. No, maybe 3 times I might get up. Well, Pete, get up. So I got up in front of everybody, and I walked out in the hallway. No man, he's gone. But a guard came up to me and said, what are you looking for? I said, I'm looking for the man that was standing there. I don't know who he was, maybe Jesse or something like that. He said, okay, that's interesting. And I went back and sat down. About 5 minutes later, there was this tap on my shoulder. And I turned around, and there was the guard, the corrections officer. She said, Jesse's waiting for you out in the hallway. Really? So I went outside and talked to Jesse. And I said, here's what we're talking about inside there with Kairos. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. If you just believe that Jesus Christ died on a cross for you, you can accept him into your heart right now. Do you believe that? He said, yes, I do. So the two of us prayed at that particular moment. I turned to another brother, you know him, Brian Reed. And I said, Brother Brian, come on over and meet your new brother in Jesus Christ. So that's how the nudges I get. Some are just as simple as saying, nudge. Others are 3 times speaking to me. You might say to yourself, Pete, you might be bold, but I'm not really that bold. How many times have I done that in my whole life? 5, 6 times maybe. Some people receive it. Some people won't. If you're afraid of reject, you might be rejected. What is my boldest? Am I bold? Well, my knees have stopped shaking from being up here. It just says, do it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Pete. Those are some really powerful stories about how we can go out and just tell other people about who Jesus is, who God is, and what Jesus can do for them. I love to hear, you know, your stories, which you come in and share from time to time with me, and other people do as well. I feel very privileged that I get to hear them, and I'm glad that each of you got to hear these two stories that Pete shared for us. In fact, Pete's story is kind of an example of what we're going to talk about today, which is what I think of as 3D evangelism. And the first D is like developing an interest in people, noticing that that homeless guy was there in the restaurant and being willing to go and strike up a conversation with him and talk to him. And then discovering his story, right? In this example, it was talking to him about his artwork. And, you know, oh, hey, I'm an artist too, and finding connections and becoming interested in who this guy is and finding a little bit more about his story. And then, well, and then discerning the next steps of the Spirit, which in this case was handing him a Bible and sharing with him about the story of salvation, God's story, and whether or not he accepted that. So thank you for a great example of exactly what we're going to be talking about today. So the last couple weeks now, we've been focusing on evangelism and laying a biblical foundation for how important evangelism is. We've talked about how Jesus told us to go out and make disciples of all nations, how in order to be effective salt, we've got to get out of the salt shaker. In order to be ambassadors for Christ, that we are authorized to represent Christ in this world, to go out and speak on his behalf and to share the message that he wants us to share. And then last week, we met the first biblical evangelist, a Samaritan woman at a well. And we heard her story, how she met Jesus, how her life has been changed by it, and then how she now goes out and tells other people her story. And she also kind of challenged each of us in saying that we all have a story to tell. We all have a story about a time before we really knew Jesus, before we really accepted him as Lord and Savior, and he was a central and important part of our lives, and then how that gradually or suddenly came to be. And how Christ did become our Lord and Savior through our acceptance. And then afterward, how that's changed us, what difference that makes in our lives and how we're different people. So she shared her story and said, we each have that story. It may not be quite as dramatic, but we each have that story to share. But the next question is, well, okay, but how do you share that? How do you talk about that? Most of us here are probably not the type of people who are going to randomly knock on doors and say, hey, let me tell you about Jesus. Or go up to a stranger in a grocery store and say, hey, I want to tell you my story about Jesus. So today we're going to focus on how do we intentionally cultivate opportunities to talk about our faith. Because that's what Jesus did. That's what he did in that woman at the well story. And that's what he sent his disciples out to do, those 70 that he sent on a mission trip. So the first thing we're going to do this morning is look at the woman at the well story. Last week we looked at that story from the woman's perspective, but now we're going to see what Jesus has to teach us, what we can learn from him about evangelism through that story. How did he approach this woman? And it kind of starts with our first D. He developed an interest in her. He started a conversation. A conversation at that time that was strictly forbidden, you might recall, between a man and a woman, a Jew and a Samaritan. But just by asking her for a drink of water, he engages her. He notices her. They start this conversation. It was someone, he didn't knock on her door, he didn't tackle her in the middle of the street. It was just as they were going about their daily lives, their paths cross each other, and he engages her in conversation and notices her. Jesus, you can see throughout his life, was intentionally developing an interest in others. He was starting conversations, noticing people, and being attentive to them. We can do that. We do that all the time. All the time. It might be saying, hey, how you doing to the cashier at the store. It may be talking to the bank teller about the game last night. It may be talking to the parents of the kids on your kid's soccer team. about, you know, the weather. It might be asking someone in the grocery store about which product is better and have they used any of them before. Or it could just be walking around your neighborhood and you notice someone's garden, you ask them for gardening tips. But we know how to start conversations with people. I mean, we do that every single day. But what if some, not all, but what if some of those conversations might lead to sharing our faith? What if some of those conversations were taken to a deeper level? That's what Jesus did with the Samaritan woman. They started talking about water, hey, can I get a drink? And then Jesus brings up living water, and she's intrigued by this conversation. But then he starts to discover her story. It starts to get more personal. No longer is it chit-chat, talking about something on the surface. He goes deeper, and he asks her about her family, or lack thereof. It's the second D of 3D evangelism, discovering people's stories. So he asks her about her husband, knowing that there's a painful story underneath that. Now, she wasn't willing to talk about it at that moment. She changes the topic and talks about worship and theology among Jews and Samaritans. But he opens the door. He lets her know, I care about who you are, and I'm open to having that conversation. That's discovering her story. And notice, he doesn't make her talk about her 5 failed marriages and the guy she's with now who's not her husband. He's not there to shame her or guilt her into all the things she's doing wrong. In fact, he goes along with her conversation. You want to talk about theology, Jews and Samaritans? That's fine. You're not ready to go deeper at the moment? That's all right. But he lets her know. He gives her the attention, the time. He listens, and he's genuinely interested in what she has to say. We also know how to do that. We do that all the time. You do that when you're talking to someone, and you start with the weather or with sports, but then you start going deeper. So what do you do for a living? Do you have a family? Where'd you go to school? Where'd you grow up? You start learning who people are, their interests, their hobbies, their background. And quite naturally, we start to make connections. Oh, you're an artist? I'm an artist too. Let's talk about, you know, that topic. Oh, you went to college there? Oh, I have a buddy who went there. Do you know so-and-so? Oh, your hometown is that place? I've been there. What a beautiful place it is. We start to make connections with people. We start to get to know them, discovering their stories and who they are. It's often called relational evangelism. Like Pete said, and a relationship or a friendship could last 20 seconds or it could last 5 years. But we get to know people. We develop an interest in them. We discover their stories and who they are over a certain amount of time. And then finally, the third D is we discern the next steps of the Spirit. So going back to Jesus and the Samaritan woman again, he discerned that she was ready for the truth. And he tells her, one of the very few people he tells, that he is the Messiah. That he is the Son of God, the Christ. And once he reveals this to her, then she's compelled to go out and tell all these other people. And they come and have a conversation with him themselves. And then there's an invitation. And here's a discernment of what the next steps are, because they invite him to stay for 2 days. Now, this was not on his calendar. He wasn't planning to stay in a Samaritan town for 2 extra days. He's on his way to Judea, or from Judea to Galilee. He's on his way to Galilee. So does he take time out of his busy schedule? to be in relationship with them? And as a Jew, does he stay in a Samaritan town, which is strictly forbidden to even talk to people, much less stay in their town? But he discerns that that is the next step. He accepts the invitation. He stays with them for 2 days, and he continues to build that relationship, to share who he is, who God is, to talk about faith and spiritual matters. We can do that. We develop an interest in someone and strike up a conversation with someone we don't know. We can discover their story, their interests, their hobbies, and then just ask the Spirit, ask God, okay, what's the next step? What do you want me to do next? And if you don't get it the first time, like Pete said, you know, God might nudge you 3 times. To do what's next? Is it an opportunity to share your story about your faith? Is it an opportunity to invite someone to church? Or do you just say, after they've told you the challenges they're going through, maybe you just say, you know what, I'm going to pray for you. Maybe it's a way to help them or connect them with a resource or to offer them food or to give them a Bible. What is the next step, the nudge that the Spirit asks you to do in that particular conversation at that time? Maybe it's even saying, hey, you want to get together for coffee next week to continue the conversation. You never know how God is going to use one conversation in order to affect someone's life and touch them in some way. Never ignore a nudge or a whisper from God. And in fact, I know people who do this intentionally, who engage in a conversation and are continually asking the Spirit, all right, God, what do you want me to say here? What do you want me to do next? Is there an opportunity to bring faith into this conversation? And if the nudge isn't there, we don't follow it. But if the nudge is there, do we have the courage to follow? Pete's story was about 3D evangelism, and I see Jesus' story. And you can look at that through 3D evangelism, developing an interest in the Samaritan woman, discovering her story, and discerning that the next step is to stay in that village for 2 days to continue the conversation. He also sent out his disciples to do the same thing, 3D evangelism. So let's look at Luke's passage again. Now, oftentimes when we think of Jesus' disciples, we think of his 12 core guys, but really, there were dozens and dozens and dozens of people, men and women, who followed him wherever he went those 3 years of his ministry. And in this case, there's 70 people who've kind of been appointed and recruited to go out in twos, to go and to evangelize, to spread the good news, to go into the towns where he's going to go eventually, kind of maybe to pave the way or to check things out and see what these towns are about. So he's got these 70 people together, and they're like, you know, are you ready to go? And yes, they're excited, and we're going to go out, and we're going to share Jesus' message. And so Jesus gets them together one last time before he sends them out and to prepare them. And he says, all right, are you ready? Yes. You're going to share the message about the kingdom of God? Yes. He's like, great, because you're going out like lambs in the midst of wolves. Wait. What'd he say? We're the wolves, right? I would think that kind of took the enthusiasm down a notch. Then he said, oh, yeah, and all those bags, like, you know, you're preparing for this journey. Yeah, you could just leave those. You don't need a bag. You don't need a purse. You don't need sandals. Just go. We don't need what? If we don't take food with us, what are we going to eat? If we don't take money with us, well, where are we going to stay? There's no plan B. We can't take our cell phone chargers. What if our batteries run out? What, what do you mean we can't take our stuff with us? This is the stuff that makes us feel secure. It gives us a safety net. But I think that's what Jesus was getting at. That's why he told them to leave all that, because he said, you know, you can't trust in your stuff. You can't trust in plan B. You can't trust in you providing for yourself. You got to trust in me, says Jesus. And I will provide. Remember the Israelites in the wilderness? God provided the manna every single day. I will provide as you go out to do evangelism. You don't need your stuff. You don't need to memorize hundreds and hundreds of Bible verses. You don't need to know every single answer to every possible question you could be asked. You don't need to know theology inside and out for every single doctrine. Just go. Share your story. Share the story of the Bible and how much God loves them in Jesus Christ. And they did. The 70 went out to 35 different villages, places they had never been before. They didn't know a soul, and they didn't take anything with them. And they went to do 3D evangelism. They started conversations with people when they went there. Not along the road, because they were on a mission. Don't get sidetracked. Go straight to that village. But when you get there, start talking with people. Develop an interest in others. And start discovering their stories. And as they engage and get to know people, the people in the village also got to know them and said, well, you know, it's lunchtime. Where's your lunchbox? Oh, yeah, I didn't bring any food with me. Well, why don't you have lunch with me and we can talk about it? Or, well, where are you staying tonight? You at the hotel? No, I didn't bring any money with me. Well, why don't you stay at my place tonight? So by not providing for themselves, it opens an opportunity to deepen a relationship with someone else. And as they were eating together at the same table, as they were staying together in the houses, they got to know the people in these villages. And then they discerned the next step. Who do we cure? What demons do we cast out? How do we preach the kingdom of God is near, and who do we preach it to? They were discerning by the Spirit what to do next. 3D evangelism. And what was exciting is that when they came back, they had all these stories to share. You'll never believe what happened, Jesus. He's like, yeah, well, I probably can't believe it. Jesus, you won't. It's amazing. The demons, they just left. They submitted under your name. Now, I don't know anyone who's cast out demons before, but I've seen that excitement, that kind of yes feeling when we're doing what God wants us to be doing. I've heard it from those who've gone on mission trips, the people who've gone on mission trips and who have come back, whether it was to another country, or whether it was helping, clean up after a natural disaster, or maybe it was to Montreat or Massanetta, but these stories of people who they themselves have been changed, and they just might have changed the life of someone else, God using them to touch someone else. I've heard that excitement from individuals who call or might come into my office and say, you'll never believe the conversation I just had. You'll never believe what happened to me. And I ran into someone, and then the conversation led here and there, and we ended up talking about church or faith. And it's amazing, these stories that come back when we're open to the nudge of the Holy Spirit and what those next steps might be. So imagine if just once a day, or how about just once a week, we were intentional about going out into this world and developing an interest in someone, striking up a conversation with a waitress, a bank teller, a friend, a family member, a neighbor, a coworker, a fellow student at school, somebody, anybody. And we started to pay attention to them and to listen and to develop an interest and discover their stories and who they are. And then we prayed the whole time, all right, God, what do you want me to do in this conversation? What are the next steps? What are you nudging me to say or to do? And it just might be an opportunity to talk about faith, to bring God into a conversation. I know there was one time that I was at Walmart checking out and talking to the cashier and, you know, hey, how you doing? And somehow she was, you know, having a rough time, single mom, and she was, you know, trying to just figure out how it all comes together. And at the time, my husband Nelio was out of town, so for a week I was a single mom trying to figure things out and run the kids around and figure out how to do it all. And I just told her, I said, you know what helps me in this time is my church family. Because they're able to help pick the kids up when I need to, or they're able to rally around me or pray for me or be a community for me when I don't have anybody else living in the same town I'm living in. It was an opportunity just to bring faith, church, God into a conversation right there at Walmart. The people behind me probably didn't appreciate it very much. But it's that simple to authentically somehow share your faith with someone else and the difference God has made in your life. Because you see, just like, you know, the 3D glasses bring a movie to life, you can see a movie from a whole new perspective when you put on 3D glasses. Well, when you do 3D evangelism, it just gives you a whole new perspective on life. As we follow in the footsteps of Jesus and share his message, his gospel, with the world. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we thank you that you've given us examples in Scripture about how to go and share your message, to tell others about Jesus. We thank you for the stories that we hear that inspire us and encourage us. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, which nudges us, telling us what to say and when to say it. May we be open to that Spirit. May we pray every day, use us to point someone toward Jesus today. We thank you, Lord, that you give us that great commission and you give us the tools and the encouragement we need to go out. To go out and to evangelize. To tell others about you and who you are and the abundant life that you offer each and every one of us. May we reach out to our neighbors with that good news. Deepen our faith. So that we might follow your nudgings, your whisperings, your promptings. Deepen our relationship with you through prayer, through scripture, as we study your word, as we commune with you in prayer, and as we seek to be in tune with what your will is for us and others. And deepen the relationships that we have with others, that we might care enough about them and for them, that we would be willing to share your gospel with them. And, oh Lord, we come to you in prayer because we know prayer is powerful. And we pray for all those who are hurting. We pray for those who are in the hospital this day, for those who are struggling with their finances, for those who are cleaning up after a devastating hurricane. We pray for those who don't know you, who are far from you, who don't have the hope, the joy that only you can offer. We pray, O Lord, for those who are overseas serving this country. We ask protection for them, that you would watch over them and bring them home safe. Lord, we pray for our family and friends who are hurting, for those who face devastating news and illnesses and diagnoses. Oh Lord, we come to you in prayer. We ask that you would use us in your way, in your time, that you might even answer someone else's prayer through us. And now we pray, O Lord, as we join together and we remember the prayer that Jesus shared with his disciples. As we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As I mentioned at the beginning of the service today, during our closing song, we will be collecting a special offering for the hurricane victims of Florence. And these money will go to Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, who are oftentimes the first people in a crisis and the last people to leave. So I invite you to give, to act, and to pray that we might be the hands and feet of Christ in the midst of so many who are hurting. I invite you to stand as we join now in our closing song, I Will Follow. Sunday, we have about 200 people that come to worship here. If each of us, just once a week, practiced 3D evangelism, then in 1 year, we would touch 10,000 people in this community. So my friends, go out and look for opportunities to discern the Spirit, to share your faith, and know that God goes with you every minute of every day. Alleluia. Amen.